Disney has released many animated musicals. Most of Disney's songs are beloved because they strengthen their stories, give the audience a chance to connect with characters, and sound amazing even outside the movies. Many fans have grown up with these classic Disney songs and have memorized their catchy and sometimes meaningful lyrics. Not every Disney song impressed fans, though. Some have faded from their audience's memory, or are regarded as musical mistakes. Beauty the Beast is filled with some of the most spectacular visuals and music, which is why so many people still hold the movie in high regard. Human Again was cut from the original release of the film but was re-added to later DVD releases. Human Again isn't as catchy as the rest of Beauty the Beast's soundtrack, and the visuals of the castle servants feel like repeated imagery seen in other songs. While the song was originally cut for time rather than quality, it's not particularly memorable either. Much of Encanto's success is thanks to the outstanding musical numbers in the film. However, the song What Else Can I Do? Sung by the oldest Madrigal sister, Isabella, is a little lackluster. The song has a great message about letting loose to find one's passion. Yet, the music and lyrics seem rather blasé in between more emotionally impactful and boisterous songs like We Don't Talk About Bruno and Dos Oroguitas. What Else Can I Do? Is a good song, but it's the least impactful in a movie full of amazing music. When Vanellope gazes into a pool of water and reflects, she bursts into a song about a racing game called Slaughter Race in Ralph Breaks the Internet. It is a parody of other princess musicals, since she loves the game for its chaotic violence, standing in stark contrast with most princesses' I Want songs. While A Place Called Slaughter Race itself is catchy, Vanellope isn't the greatest singer. In what is probably a comedic choice, her voice cracks multiple times when reaching for the higher notes. Fortunately, the other singers in this musical piece are solid. Combined with its fantastic visuals, people can still have fun with A Place Called Slaughter Race despite its flaws. Throughout the entirety of Frozen 2, Kristoff keeps trying and failing to propose to Anna. Anna is wrapped up in her sister's problems and afraid she'll lose her again. Despite this, Kristoff continues to make proposal attempts, and the resulting misunderstandings only strain their relationship. Lost in the Woods is set in a different musical genre than the rest of Frozen 2's songs. This, combined with odd backup vocals from Reindeer and recycled animation from the love interests' short time together, made the song fall flat. What's the issue, dear? Why are you holding back from Frozen's man? Trolls are considered the film's weakest characters, and their main function is to explain Elsa's powers. Their song, Fixer Upper, is so disliked because of how unnecessary it is. Anna is dying from her frozen heart, yet the trolls don't allow her or Kristoff to get a single word in. Instead, Kristoff's erstwhile family tries to marry the two romantically uninvolved friends. When they find out Anna is engaged, they insist that her engagement is just one of her flaws. The melody isn't bad, but the message and tone made Fixer Upper an ill fit for the film. Dumbo is a classic animated film about a sweet elephant who wants to be accepted for who he is. Unfortunately, Dumbo is not always treated with kindness, which manifests in a dream he has later in the show. In Pink Elephants on Parade, Dumbo's subconscious conjures up horrifying facsimiles of rosy misshapen elephants with pits for eyes that dance around in the dark. The song is eerie and gave many young fans nightmares of their own. Many agree that it was an unnecessary addition to a children's movie. Villain songs are usually reserved for the best of Disney's villains. During these songs, they reveal their evil plan to the audience or other characters. Through great singing and stunning visuals, villains steal the spotlight. Unfortunately, Moana gives a villain song to a giant crab that appears for a tiny portion of the movie. All he does is sing about his greed and obsession with all things shiny. It feels needless and lacks any real substance that would incentivize fans to go back and listen to it again. When the apes come across the human encampment in Tarzan, they start breaking things left and right. They find a rhythm in the chaos and create their own song. While creating music from random objects takes a lot of creativity, the breaking sounds, combined with wacky sound effects, don't make a great song. The trumpet is the song's saving grace, but it is often interrupted by the clanging of metal or glass. It also does not contribute much to the overall story, making Trash in the Camp song one of the least memorable pieces in Tarzan. Scales and Arpeggios is an adorable song sung by kittens in the Aristocats. It's not hard to see why some fans are attached to the song, as it's tied to the cute imagery of kittens playing the piano and singing. The song is performed by children who aren't vocal powerhouses. While the music is short and sweet, this isn't like Disney's other songs, which fans would go out of their way to listen to over and over again. As adorable as Scales and Arpeggios is, it remains one of Disney's weaker entries. Thank you for watching my killer video this far. I hope you enjoyed what you have seen so far. Please don't forget to like, share, and most importantly, subscribe to be notified of my future videos. Now, onto the rest of this video. What are you guys talking about? If I know Esmeralda, she's 3 steps ahead of Frollo. The Hunchback of Notre Dame is a surprising release from Disney because of how mature, dark, and sad its story gets. What some fans of the film criticize the most are the three gargoyles that are meant to serve as comic relief. They're supposed to make the film seem more kid-friendly, but in reality, they overstay their welcome and are obnoxious. Unfortunately, the three gargoyles get their own song where they try to convince Quasimodo that Esmeralda would surely return his feelings. A guy like you doesn't sound as good when disliked characters are singing it. The Little Mermaid was the beginning of the Disney Renaissance. Its beautiful animation is only outmatched by its incredible musical numbers. However, not all the songs are hits. The first song that plays is Fathoms Below, which tells the mythos of King Triton and the mysterious mermaids who live below the surface of the ocean. It also warns listeners to beware of the mermaids, especially King Triton's wrath. Though it is understandable to lay the groundwork for how mermaids are perceived on land, Prince Eric, Grimsby, and other humans are already discussing the issue, making Fathoms Below pointless. When Ariel finally arrives at Prince Eric's castle, she is welcomed with luxury and amenities that she has never known. Unfortunately, the same can't be said for her trusty crustacean companion, Sebastian. Sebastian finds he is on that evening's menu and has to escape from a rather determined chef who wants to serve him up. As Chef Louis goes about making a seafood extravaganza, he sings Les Poissons, which is a love letter to ocean cuisine. The whole song has a rather sinister undertone, being in a movie about talking fish. Plus, this is one of only 2 scenes where Louis is featured, making this an all-around pointless, disturbing song. A jingle is a short song that tends to get stuck in people's heads for extended periods. Canine Crunchies is no different. The jingle appears on the television that the Dalmatians are watching in 101 Dalmatians. A series of high-pitched voices sing this jingle advertising dog treats, something that the puppies find endearing. In reality, playing this song over and over again would be the opposite of a good time. Fans are better off listening to something else. While Cinderella is known for its beautiful music, it's also notorious for the titular character's 2 stepsisters, Anastasia and Drizella. Unlike Cinderella, Anastasia and Drizella aren't particularly kind or talented. Yet, their mother forces them to practice their musical talents on the off chance that they marry men who enjoy music. This sets the scene for the song, Sing Sweet Nightingale. As Anastasia plays the flute dissonantly, Drizella comes in with an abrasively off-key voice. Though audiences are treated to Cinderella's more soothing take on the song a few moments later, the harshness of Drizella's rendition was too much for many fans. Though it is sung this way to show how different Cinderella and her stepsisters are, there are plenty of other clues that portray the same idea without the grating song.
You are so right.
Forget about that guy.
Aladdin boasts several fan favorite songs, A Whole New World among them. However, when fans watched the Aladdin, no one wished Iago had his own musical number. Yet, the sequel gave Iago multiple songs to sing. What makes Forget About Love the worst song is the fact that Iago sings alongside Jasmine and Aladdin. Instead of saving the song, the love interests instead make Iago's singing sound more grating in comparison. While some fans may revisit the return of Jafar, the music isn't the reason why.